Steve.
Whoever stands.
Good morning, church family.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship on this cool and cloudy Sunday morning. We don't have too many announcements this morning, but I do want to start putting in your brains the plan for summer worship for July and August. I'm going to announce this for the next few weeks so we get it out to as many ears as possible while folks go on their different summer vacations and things, because we're doing it a little bit differently than we've done it in the past few years, at least since I've been with you guys, right? So here's what's different. We are not changing the worship time this summer. Let me repeat that. We are going to remain at 10:15 all summer long. No changing to 9 a.m. this summer. So hopefully this is actually easier on your brains. We will stay right at 10:15 straight through to September. Here's what we're going to do instead. Starting in July, for all of July and August, we will move downstairs and enjoy worship in our beautifully renovated fellowship hall, thanks to Reese and the Boy Scouts. So to recap, rest of this month, June, upstairs, 10:15. July and August, we will be downstairs in Fellowship Hall, but we will still be at 10:15. So we'll try this experiment and we'll see if everyone enjoys getting that extra half hour or so of sleep on their summer mornings, or to linger over coffee or whatever have you. Alright. And I think that was the only announcement I had this morning for a change. Other news or announcements from the community? Bruce.
I just wanted to announce that yesterday in Fellowship Hall, our church hosted Camp Cocoon, which is part of the Lehigh Valley Health Network bereavement services. And it's about a 4-hour program that we've been fortunate to host for several years now downstairs. And the counselors have kids who have lost loved ones recently. I think the youngest one yesterday was only 6 years old. She lost her dad recently. So it's a very worthwhile program. And at the end, the kids plant flowers for their loved ones. So if you had a chance to look out the front door, you'll see all the beautiful flowers in the landscape areas. And that's all I wanted to tell you. Oh, there will be probably some photos in the newsletter. The next newsletter, and unfortunately they'll only be black and white in the printed version, but online, if you're able to go online, you'll see the colored photos, which are pretty nice.
And of course, take a stop as you head out in front of the double doors. The flowers really are beautiful. I looked at them on my way in this morning. So yes, we are very grateful to be able to host Camp Cocoon year in and year out. This is why we are a church, to be able to supply what we can to our community, even if that's just the space to hold a worthwhile event for children. So thank you for the update on Camp Cocoon's latest support event here. Any other news or announcements from the community? Then we will let the chimes bring us into worship. God welcomes everyone.
So everyone is welcome here.
And so I invite everyone to rise as you're able, and we will join together in our call to worship. in all times and in all places, God is with us.
God is with us.
Shout for joy.
Sing praises to God.
Get ready to become disciples for Jesus.
Let us ready ourselves to serve the Savior through our time together this morning.
And let us ready to worship with song. We will sing the first 3 verses of our opening hymn, which is number 49 in your hymnals.
Serve you.
come to us and bring us home.
To the place where we recognize and respond to all that you do for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. And as we have prayed out loud together, so we also take a moment for the prayers within our own hearts in silence. Do not doubt God's power and might, for it is God who has called to your hearts and spirits. God is with us, and so we proclaim.
Praise be to God.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Living Word, we know that you are still speaking in our hearts and minds today. You speak in the sunrise, in the sounds of approaching summer, and in the sparkling of the distant stars. You also continue to speak through our faith ancestors, through your poetry and their letters, and it is these we turn to hear you now. And the people say, our first reading this morning is from the Psalms, which is a collection of ancient Hebrew poetry used by the people to express their feelings and fears, as well as their praise to God. Though our psalm for today begins from a place of feeling distant from God, the depths, it continues into words of hope and ends in a positive proclamation. We read from Psalm 130, beginning at the first verse from the New International Version's translation of the Bible. Out of the depths I cry to you, Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to my cry for mercy. If you, Lord, kept the record of sins, Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness so that we can, with reverence, serve you. I wait for the Lord, my whole being waits, and in his word I put my hope. I wait for the Lord more than watchmen wait for the morning, more than watchmen wait for the morning. Israel, put your hope in the Lord, for with the Lord is unfailing love, and with him is full redemption. He himself will redeem Israel from all their sins. Here ends the first reading. Our second reading for this morning is from Paul's second letter to the Corinthian church. In this section, he expresses confidence about his faith in Christ, despite current suffering. Because any struggles we might face and the present will eventually fall away when we are made complete in Christ, we should continue to testify to our faith. We read from chapter 4, beginning at verse 13. But I, just as we have the spirit of faith that is in accordance with Scripture, I believed and so I spoke, we also believe and therefore we also speak, because we know that the one who raised Jesus will also raise us with Jesus and will present us with you in his presence. Indeed, everything is for your sake, so that grace, when it has extended to more and more people, may increase thanksgiving to the glory of God. So we do not lose heart, even though our outer nature is wasting away, our inner nature is being renewed day by day. For our slight momentary affliction is producing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all measure, because we look not to what can be seen, but at what cannot be seen. For what can be seen is temporary, but what cannot be seen is eternal. For we know that if the earthly tent we live in is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Here ends the readings for today. May they be a lamp for our feet.
Amen.
Thank you, Karen. So interactive moments where I want you to shout out your answers this time, okay? So here's what I want you to shout out. Shout out some examples of the kind of thing you look forward to with high expectations. Kind of thing you look forward to and have high expectations for.
Getting married.
Getting married, that's a good one. Very good.
Birth of a child.
Birth of a child, good, I like it. What else? I'll say one because it's on my mind, a vacation. What else?
Graduations.
Graduations, I like it.
Mornings.
Mornings, good, ah, I like that.
Birthdays.
Birthdays, ah, that's a good one. Anything else? Yeah, those are all really good examples. Excellent. So as you have all those examples that folks shouted out bouncing around in your head, maybe you're thinking of your own marriages or graduations or birthdays that you had high expectations for, trips that you took that you had high expectations for. Think about times when maybe things didn't live up to your expectations. The graduation didn't go as planned. They didn't throw you the surprise party you were hoping they would. Things like that. When things don't live up to your high expectations for them, how do you react? Think about that as we go into our sermon and as we sing our sermon hymn, only two verses in our hymn, in our sermon hymn. So we will sing both verses of number 413. You may rise as you're able. New things or new chapters in our lives great expectations. We look to the future with hope, anticipating the joys this new thing or new chapter that we've been looking forward to will bring us. We feel this way, especially if we consider the new thing to be a turning point, a life-changing event. One way or another, this new event, graduation, a birth, a move, will bring transformation. For example, as someone called out, we typically start a marriage with much celebration. Under the best circumstances, our families and friends gather to rejoice with us, dancing, eating, laughing, sometimes even cheering. Not always, but many weddings take place in a worship service. We feel God's presence in the vows and the music. After the wedding, though, after the cake and the dancing, we have to build the marriage. After time, the glow of the ceremony fades away. We have to pay bills, perhaps decide on children, take care of a house. We know what can happen. Arguments, tears, hurt feelings. We know we can't keep all of the feelings of the wedding day going for years and decades, even if we try to at least keep some of the joy and tenderness alive amid the stress of life. We know, of course, that sometimes marriages take a darker turn. Not all marriages work out, even when everything started off so well. The external pressures of the outer world, the day-to-day struggles sometimes overwhelm those feelings of joy and tenderness, those best intentions, the inner well we draw on to keep the marriage intact. The inner and the outer clash. And while oftentimes the inner feelings are enough to sustain the relationship through rough patches, sometimes relationships crumble under the outer pressures of the world. One more example. When we join a new church, either because we've moved or we've felt called somewhere new, or perhaps as a youth affirming our baptism. When we join somewhere new, we are awash with the love and affirmation of the congregation. The new member or the confirmation service brings up pride and affection. We may feel as though we've added a church family to our existing family. We anticipate the ways we will learn, the ways we will grow as we share celebratory cake and coffee. We trust that God will be with us as we become part of this particular branch of the body of Christ. But eventually, we realize that the new church, like all churches, is filled with humans. And the new congregation, like all congregations faces its own struggles. And while we certainly might still find the good in the new church, we might also feel like there is too much work for too few hands, that the budget is too stretched, that the same people we ate cake with can frustrate or anger us in times of conflict. At best, we learn to balance our inner expectations with the outer realities of being part of a community. And we learn to make the best out of the imperfect human church family we've adopted. But at worst, those outer realities crush our initial hopes, smother our enthusiasm, and we give up. We leave because the community was not good enough. Not all that we dreamed it would be. We can start off with great expectations on so many things, only to run into reality. Besides joining a particular church, what about trying to serve as the church, capital C, church in the world? We see the actions and the ministries the church needs to do. We see the hurt, the hunger, both spiritual and physical, and we see the divisions. We decide to jump in as the church and do our part, only to find the divisions and the hunger, the outer needs are growing all the time, despite our best efforts. How can we try so hard with genuine faith, only to become so very disappointed, so very disillusioned? The Apostle Paul could answer that question. After his life-changing moment on the road to Damascus, he began his ministry of going to synagogues to proclaim that Jesus was the Messiah with deep conviction. In 1 Thessalonians, likely his earliest letter, we see some of his initial joy in ministry. He gives thanks for the church in Thessalonica. He celebrates that the reputation for their faith has spread far and wide. These kinds of things energize those who do ministry, and we see Paul's inner zeal lifted up by them. By the time Paul wrote 2 Corinthians, which we read from this morning, though, he had felt the burden of the problems that can drag down a person's passion for ministry. In chapter 6, he tells us about beatings and imprisonments, false accusations, and grief. Many people would have given up and gone back to tent making at so many outer stresses. But Paul didn't give up. He says earlier in chapter 4, just before our passage for today, we are afflicted in every way, but not crushed, perplexed, but not driven to despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed. And then in our reading for today, Paul tells us what keeps him going. He looks to the time of spiritual completion, when we will trade our earthly tent for a building from God. He could look at everything he had endured and call it a slight momentary affliction. He focused instead on the eternal weight of glory, which we can think of as a glory so solid, so substantive, that we know it will last and really matter. This is not an outer weight we have to carry or pick up, but an inner weight that undergirds us. The inner weight of God's eternal glory steadies Paul against any outer storms. Paul looks to the glory that pulls him forward and keeps him going. By the grace of God, all of who we are will be renewed, even if it currently looks like all we do here is grow older and grayer. In the eternal glory, we will experience reconciliation with God and one another. Those assurances drew Paul forward, gave him the resources to keep going, and enabled him to shake off the outer troubles that could have led him to give up, to abandon his church growing. He spoke out of that inner faith. His words rose out of what he trusted in his heart. He conquered the pain of beatings because of his faith in the glory of God. He rose above the shame and confinement of prison because of his faith in the glory of God. He held his head high despite false accusations, because of his faith in the glory of God. When he faced physical hunger on his journeys, he fed his soul with the assurance of the eternal glory of God. Paul knew the joy of ministry, but he also knew that over time it held pitfalls that could drag him down. He kept putting one foot in front of the other in his ministry, though, because the glory of a house not made by human hands shone like a beacon to guide him forward. So what about us? Just a few weeks ago, we celebrated Pentecost, the explosion of the Holy Spirit that compelled the church out into the world to do ministry. Like Paul and the other apostles, we hopefully still feel bursts of energy from the Holy Spirit, feel renewals of our commitment to get out there in the world, to speak our word, and do our work. At the same time, we may also worry about what might happen to our energy and commitment. Just as when we start a new thing in our lives, the obstacles, the resistance, the castles may threaten to drag us down. We may encounter resource shortages, apathy, and hostility to the church's message of peace and justice. If we try to do something important about racism or poverty, we may encounter name-calling or pushback. If we share our message with the unchurched, people may disappoint us. Like Paul, we have felt the frustrations while trying to do the ministry of the church. Like Paul, we have likely felt tempted to give up. Like Paul and like the Corinthian church he wrote to, the outer pressures of the world can seem like enough reason to lose heart. But we also have the same promise Paul reminded them of, that all of this is but a momentary affliction compared to the eternal weight of the glory of God. So like Paul, we may be afflicted, but we are not crushed, perplexed, but not despairing, struck down, but not destroyed. Whatever outer challenges we face, our inner spirits are being renewed day by day until we reach the house not made by human hands, our home that is in eternal glory. So let us not lose heart. Let us not give up. Let us endure. We have the same one who raised Jesus pushing us forward. We have the glory ahead of us pulling us towards it. We have the energy and power of the Holy Spirit filling our souls and the collective soul of the church. We may feel weary or discouraged. We may not always be able to see what good our work does. We may feel underappreciated. We may wonder if we have what it takes. But God's power is behind us. The weight of glory glows ahead of us. Either one alone could keep us moving, and we have both together, empowering our ministry as they did Paul's. Let us claim both forces in our lives and in our work for the church. Let us allow each to feed our spirits. Let us hold on to the weight of God's glory until the day when we enter the eternal house made for us by God. And in the meantime, let us not lose heart as we live out our faith. Amen. Friends, as we prepare to pray together, are there any joys, concerns, prayer requests to share from the community this morning? Okay. And let's pray, church family. Renewing God, in this summery season of growth, open our hearts to grow in your love. Help us to truly anchor ourselves in your creative process in our lives. We look around and we see the beauty of your world, the blossoming flowers and plants, the growth of children, the joy of celebrations of graduation and marriage, of receiving new life. And we also see the sadness and sorrow that has invaded the world when systems of injustice and hatred lay claim to people's lives. Help us to not lose heart, but instead prepare us, O Lord, to become ambassadors of peace and hope. Help us to place our trust in you, so that when we are serving others, they may come to know your abiding love and power. Whatever outer challenges we face, give us inner courage and joy as we serve you. And as we pray the way you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, our offertory, I invite you to meditate on how the anchoring weight of God's glory helps you to not lose heart. Offering these tokens of our commitment to your church. so that your love may be more widely known. Amen. We will sing all the verses of our closing hymn this morning. We'll be singing number 386 in your hymnals. Be with you always. Amen.